Namaste everyone. Welcome to the module on corporate governance. Here we would learn about the critical issues, framework, and how you can help your institution to be knowledge reservoir and promote innovation in this area. It is so crucial for management teachers to understand the trends in corporate governance. For instance, as an unpleasant surprise to his fans across the world, one of the prominent business magnates, Elon Musk, quoted that he would step down from the post of CEO in Tesla pursuant to a discussion with SEC of the USA. Coming to India, while the much talked about Tata Group and the Infosys seem to have very well resolved the governance issues, many organizations like Mahindra & Mahindra, State Bank, HDFC, L&T have set up high benchmarks of governance. There are questions on governance aspects of few of the banks and NBFCs in India. When we discuss about scenario, in the contemporary times, the idea of VUCA, which stands for volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity, surfaces up. But as a Bharati citizen, we have to always learn about the concept of Kaliyug, which explains all the mishappening occurring in these times far better. Fortunately, our scriptures don't end here. Like Bhagavad Gita guides us to follow the path of Karma Yoga to improve the reality around making the best of our efforts. So, talking about the business world, in the recent times, we have seen the governance issues have gained prominence in the corporate, but we don't sit idle and let reality deter it. The constant efforts are made to improve the business practices and thus creating a sustainable world. To add on, with the advent of new technologies, monitoring and control has made this field more and more relevant. As this field, like other management areas, is always evolving, so it is always good to hear from people involved in the action that are industry people. So to begin with, let us listen what Dr. Sagarika Ghoshal, independent director, has to say on this.
You know, corporate governance in my mind is a very fiendish, difficult topic to pin down. It is also incredibly very broad, and perhaps that's why so much discussion interest generated around it, because it's really large in volume and hence needs a lot of research for common people to also understand.
Yes, as we very rightly can put up, that this topic needs a lot of research for the right understanding. And this provides all of us good research potential to work on the theme. But first, let us look at the work done till now in the terms of framework, significance, good practices, legal aspects, etc.
What does good governance mean? In my mind, it requires a credible and a trustworthy institution to build transparency and accountability, and in terms of public view. So what do we think in public perception? So there has to be a transparent dealings in whichever stakeholders, stockholders we are dealing with, and also most bit of accountability to rest of the world.
Coming back to the research part, issues like corporate governance and CSR, women as independent directors, succession planning, and executive compensation are less researched in Indian context. But what about the viewpoint of corporate towards linking corporate governance with learning from the Indian scriptures, Shastra, Kautilya Arthashastra, Vidur Niti, etc.? Friends, these have huge potential. Let us not wait for someone outside India to tell us to research on these themes. Rather, let us pull them to consult us to link these with their governance issues. Friends, many of you have heard about the catchwords like credibility, trustworthiness, transparency, and accountability, and towards whom the organization need to follow these? The stakeholders. In this time of globalization, interconnectedness, high-end technologies, and the dynamic environment, the governance become more and more relevant. The reason being, any minutest of an error might lead to the catastrophic situation for the organization and will directly affect the employees, their families, suppliers, clients, and the whole society.
Very important that since you are under magnifying glass, a small dot on you will always be magnified to a bigger circle. So it's very important as women also to make sure that you're always on the right way. Right way is a bit difficult, but stay there.
Further, when minutest care is taken and we follow the norms and regulations, the outcomes are really wonderful and encouraging. Let us listen to an interesting incident shared by the Chief General Manager of State Bank of India, Jaipur, Sri Vijay Ranjan.
State Bank of India is in the 213th year of existence. Name changes. In 1806, Bank of Bengal was established. And I can tell you when Bank of Bengal, Bank of Madras, Bank of Bombay all merged, became Presidency Bank. At that time, the Governor General of India, who wanted to open an account with the State Bank of India, the then State Bank of India, which basically became Imperial Bank earlier, days named as Imperial Bank. He wanted to open an account. He was not having KYC. Today's KYC document and at that time KYC document were different. So he was not allowed to open.
But at the time, we also need to ensure that too much of rules and regulations do not ultimately harm the smooth practices. And listen to this very interesting metaphorical study quoted by Dr. Harish Krishnaswamy, COO of the Tata Trusts.
There was once an ant which was working very hard. The ant, she used to come every day early. She used to enjoy. She was very happy with the work. She was producing the maximum and she was very happy. So her chief, the lion, noticed this little ant and said, "Man, she is doing such a wonderful job, but she is doing it without supervision. Imagine what kind of a quantum jump she could do in terms of production if she had a supervisor." So he immediately went to the market, put up a recruitment thing, and then recruited a cockroach. Cockroach, who was an expert on, you know, report making and tailoring, and on commercial law, all those stuff. And also, the cockroach had a very good vintage experience in supervision. So fantastic, got it done. Immediately the cockroach felt, "I can't do it alone, I need a secretary." So it immediately got a spider along with it. So the spider came. The spider was told, "Look here, all my phone calls you have to take care. You have to do it." So the spider went about, you know, it's got 8 hands, right? It's got 2 mobiles, you know, Jio, and then, you know, Airtel, Vodafone, and all this stuff. And then, you know, it was like enjoying itself. Then somewhere the lion felt that, you know, I want to impress the board, correct? There was an elephant, there was a rhino on the board. In between, a monkey also was there in the board, heartfelt. Okay, so all of them were there. So the lion decided, I have to impress the board. So the lion actually called up this cockroach and said, "Cockroach, you're very good in report making. Make a fantastic thing. Use Bill Gates thing, you know, bring up a PowerPoint and, you know, stuff like that. Let me jazz up the whole board. Give me powerful reports." So the graphs of whatever ants producing was, it all came out in jazzy, you know, visualizations, and then the board was very impressed. So this continued. But then the cockroach said, "Boss, now, you know, I can't do it alone. The report making and my spider, it's already into phone calls. 8 hands are already fulfilled. So I have to go for one more." So it recruited one housefly, which became the IT department head, which took care of all these reports and the laptop and all those stuff. And then what happened? The ant was somehow miserable, you know, with all this burden of so many people on top. It was, you know, so the lion, when he was going on his usual tour, he saw the ant was very down. Oh God, the ant is demotivated. So let me get the head of department. So the head of department was put for the ants department on top of the cockroach, which became the mosquito. Because, you know, everywhere, right? Blood sucking, right? So the mosquito was put on top. Mosquito bought one more mosquito as a secretary, right? One mosquito has never come, right? They always come on herds. So mosquito bought its mosquito as the secretary, and then they, you know, took care of the entire department. Then finally, still the ant was not happy. And then with all these reports of what this cockroach was making, the lion found out that actually the production was dipping from the first point of view when the ant was working alone. So he said, "There's something wrong. What do we do?" So then, you know, as usual as what we do in corporates, it went in search of an auditor and a consultant. So an owl was brought in. Because owl works in the night also, right? It doesn't work during the day at all. You don't know where the auditors are during the day. Only night they work. Okay. Then they come out with fat reports. So they work for 3 months, 4 months. The owl sat down for 3 months, brought about 482 pages of report of what needs to be done. And the main, you know, the recommendation was, look here, lion, you're overstaffed. And guess what? The ant was fired. You know why? Lack of motivation and no collaboration.
When we talk about Tatas, immediately we are reminded that it is not only following good business practices that are linked with the success of organization, but social responsibility is an aspect which is equally and sometimes more important.
The Tata Trust is at the helm of all the groups. So you have roughly around 96 companies of Tata, right from, you know, you're making pins, salt, you know, name it, your telecom, all those are there, right? You have your entire continuum of 96 companies of Tata, and all of their shares are held by a company, holding company called Tata Sons. Okay? And Tata Trust holds 66% of that shareholding of Tata Sons. Which means what? Which means what?
Major stakeholder.
Major stakeholder means what? I get dividends. So every person working in Tata works nicely, works productively, works efficiently, works effectively, works with a focus, works with a passion, works with enthusiasm, and then makes the company grow. And then what happens? The company gives dividends. And those dividends are given to whom? To Tata Sons. And Tata Sons, the shareholder is Tata Trust. And what do the Tata Trust do? We do all the CSR activities of the trust.
That's wonderful, isn't it? Based on the learning from such examples and with the passage of time, the social responsibility is not seen as an offshoot of business, but very much linked with the business practices.
Best corporates who have survived because they have given whatever they have earned through the whatever profit they have earned, they have shared it to the society. If you see charters, they have got so many things.
Based on these ideas, emerged the concept of integrated reporting, in which organizations see their business practices rightly linked with the employee welfare, customer satisfaction, grievance redressal, adherence with norms, and social responsibility, or also the environmental care. Now, here Sri Amitava Banerjee, who is a consultant with the National Foundation of Corporate Governance, describes it very aptly.
Integrated reporting was ESG, E, environment, social, and governance issues. So, these three things, when you integrate karte ho, only then you can apply your brains in choosing whether that company is going to sustain or not. The best example was what Sandeep ji had given regarding Rani Rashmani. What did she do? I mean, I'm not going back into what was the psychological reason, but what did she do? She built temples, she gave employment, she protected the right of people, she built a road. So what is it? It is actually creating a township.
For educational institutions, it is important to collaborate with the like-minded organizations who are working for the cause of corporate governance. And one such organization in our country is NFCG. Let us all listen about what it is about.
So the Ministry of Corporate Affairs is the apex body which governs all the companies. The Companies Act, which was 1956 earlier, now it's 2013. Is administered by the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. So Ministry of Corporate Affairs 2003 thought ki bhai humne act to implement kar liya, we should also have a think tank, a specialized think tank that goes into corporate governance, CSR, all other researches. So they incorporated three entities. One was that IICA, it's Indian Institute of Corporate Affairs, which is the pure think tank in CSR, National Voluntary Guidelines. They had NFCSR, which is National Foundation for Corporate Social Responsibility, which takes care of all the social responsibility schemes and everything about social responsibility from the government side. And then we are the NFCG. So basically, our mandate is to, you know, promote research, promote workshops like this.
So, how can you or your institute collaborate to set up National Center for Corporate Governance? Interested? There are two ways, the phased manner and the fast track. In the former, collaborate with the existing NCCG, that is the National Center for Corporate Governance, do a few programs, add corporate governance in the course curriculum, go for some research papers, PhD guidance, apply to NFCG or others, and you can just ensure that your efforts touch and they apply for the Center of Excellence. As you might appreciate that since the corporate governance has linkages with each and every aspect of business, so discussing each aspect will not be possible in the given time frame. But we will try to throw light on some of the dimensions associated with corporate governance. The first one, importance of leadership and challenges for good governance.
So Indian businesses and MNCs who are working here are facing challenges in terms of maintaining that balance, you know, to bring in sanity and for a managing director or the CEO, how challenging is it to, you know, manage all the stakeholders and the stockholders? So with stakeholders, I would mean the even the employees and the customers and the board. And how would you look at an independent director and, you know, the custodians? So how do you do the multiple stakeholder balancing being at the leadership?
And be it a small or a large organization, corporate governance challenges are the same. Because I feel that corporate governance is just laying down the rules. It has to be implemented by the people who have vision, be it small or large, should have good knowledge about the industry which they are running, and then they should also be good in values.
It is interesting to note that the importance of ethical individuals with strong determination is considered very essential for bringing good governance.
Whole thing about corporate governance is to make sure that you are transparent and consistent and sustainable.
These codifications, these laws, rules, regulations, guidelines, they just cannot bring governance in the companies. Governance has to come from the mindset only. You have n number of legislations, but you won't have governance unless you are determined to bring governance in the corporate sector.
Very true. Advocate G.P. Madan has put forward very important point of right mindset of a leader for good governance. Apart from this, the intuitive feeling of the decision maker is very, very essential. And Sri Jyoti Ghosh, for former MD of SBBJ, has an interesting case of decision making, which helped in arriving at the right conclusion.
They said yes. First they said, are you agreeable? I said, let me get the answers to my questions and then I'll say yes or no. My first question is that this company was a D-rated, default-rated borrower in one of the bigger public sector banks. 3 years back, 1.5 years back, they have paid back 7.5 crore. Has that figured in the balance sheet? They started looking at each other, the dealing officers started looking at each other. Nobody had bothered to check what is available on the net. It was there in the net. Next, my question was that are you guys aware that this gentleman has got some mining rights in one of the states for which he has to pay a 20 crore royalty to the state government? Their income generation does not provide payment of such. So from where are they getting the funds, or are they already in default? Again, they started looking at me. I said, if these two questions are answered positively, I have got no qualms in giving money. I don't think there can be a positive answer. That is how you need to put your ears to the ground and have a look and your gut feeling. What would have happened to that 40 crore if we had given 20 crore for royalty payment, 7 to 8 crore for that loan the gentleman has taken, along with interest, say 10 more, 10 is left to do business. If 40 crore is required and 10 is left to do business, business doesn't happen. It's as simple as that. So we need to really, really be focused in what we are trying to do. It's not figure work in advances, it's your gut feeling. It's not that you have to oblige everybody in life. You cannot say yes to everybody. You cannot please everybody.
That was really nice example. Wonderfully put. Let us move further. Means or ends, this is the second issue. There are debates around this idea as to what should we look for.
In our Bharatiya perspective, the means is all. Why? Because we do not have a control of the end. It's not controllable, the means are controllable.
That is really interesting. Thus, we should focus on doing our best. In this, it would be relevant to share a wonderful story of Vibhishan. He was probably one of the best whistleblowers we have ever had in our history. He tried all proper means to raise the voice against the bad practices of Ravan and asked him time and time again to free Mata Sita. But he was ousted from Lanka. Today, many people in a very casual approach can say Ghar ka bhedi Lanka dhai, but if we look at the correct perspective, he was adopting right means to bring justice to an innocent woman, and he aimed to uphold dharm. Maybe instead of blaming him, we should learn from him. The third issue is control structure of the organization and corporate governance. A myth is prevalent that in India only the business are family run, and there Dr. Vikas Balia has a different take. Let us hear his views.
When we talk of family owned businesses, we are normally talking of it's one person or a family or a group of close knit people who control those businesses. So even within USA, the original assumption was this. But when they ended up doing their data, they figured out that even in the USA, close to 90% businesses are family-owned and family-run, which is somewhat similar across the world.
Also, we should think that founder-driven companies are not keen on succession planning. Scenario is not as so bad. And Sri Rajneesh Kumar, senior president of Yes Bank, has something to say.
And let me also tell you that more and more founder-driven companies and their CEOs are also wanting to do this. Some of the topic that we talked about, succession planning and corporate governance, compliance, how do I bring more professionally qualified people? Even they are keen, right?
Further, whatever be the type of structure, planning is very essential for smooth functioning.
There is a person or a company or a business. So there is no late or early time. You always have to be ready. And the readiness, obviously, to come to practical terms, you'll always have three kinds of plans will always have to be there. So likewise, always have for succession planning, if you read it academically also, you'll find them that there is a contingent plan, which is essentially meant for if something's going to happen to you right away or to a business right away. So this happened to say, if you recall in Japan, there was a huge earthquake and tsunami 4 years ago, something, and suddenly the whole northern part was destroyed. All of those companies, you cannot plan for that. But then there's a contingent plan for the business for succession. That's always a contingent plan. If something were to happen overnight, you have it there. You should always be there at day one. The second is, which is more like a transition phase where you're basically grooming people and you have your functions which are delegated and coming in, which is an ongoing plan. And then you have a final takeover, takedown plan, which is difficult to anticipate when it's going to happen, but that's also a long process. So the earlier you start, the better. When you implement at the stage of founder's control, why I was hinting on that was, at the stage where you put in the founder's control parameters, is actually when you determine your succession plan also automatically. The impact of succession, when it's going to happen, actually is determined or starts getting determined at your birth. The business structure that you create at inception can suddenly not be given away at the time when you're planning succession. It's going to be there. your gene pool of the business is not going to go away very easily. So it has to start from day one. How you implement is dependent on your circumstances.
The fourth issue is women's role in corporate governance. It has become a fashion to criticize our culture without proper research. And Sri Sandeep Singh, with his thorough research of business systems of ancient Bharat, presents that women played significant role in the governance of business and the society, and also the other forms of organization.
He wrote first about a concept called Stri Dhan. You know, today we know about Stri Dhan more to terms of a dowry or, you know, the you get gift in wedding. But in the scriptures, if you go, so women had a right to have her own wealth from the family, and it was called Stri Dhan. And it could not be used for any purposes until unless she has approved of it. And if she approves, then only, and it says very clearly that if she approves only, then you can use it for business purposes. And this is something not new. You know, if you go back, you will find businessmen after businessmen who have used the Stri Dhan. We keep hearing a lot about Infosys founder and all the, how they used. But it goes long back, and not only wife's jewelry. The Atlas cycle you all have heard of, I'm sure, you know. So Mr. Pahwa was the founder. The two brothers founded it. So they had come to India after the partition. So they were struggling to start a business. So one day the sister came and she said, take my jewelry and you start your business. So it was not only wives, you know. So they have examples of sisters supporting brothers. And they took it. And that's how we had Atlas cycle. And if you go back, like, you know, there are examples after examples where I've seen in the modern business, Gujaramal Modi started the whole business by pawning his wife's jewelry. One of the important conditions in the when you borrow your wife's jewelry is that you must return it.
Otherwise, he also adds that it was not only the business in which women from business families played part, but women belonging to ruling class also had a great business acumen.
Ahilya Bai Holkar, she was born on 31st May 1725. She has done a lot of wonderful work. You all must study if you haven't. Here I'll mention the business context. So she was married in Indore. She had to take charge because her husband passed away and father-in-law said that she will run the show. And she realized that there was a problem of a permanent income in the residence of area near Indore. And so she invited weavers from different parts of the country and taught the people, her citizens, how to weave. And that's how we have Maheshwari sari today. So the whole designing concept was of Ahilya Bai Holkar. So she thought of complete thing, you know, it will just not be a product which you could weave throughout the year, so you'll earn income because you buy clothes almost every month, there is a festival for which you need clothes. And she thought of design, so there should be different designs in a sari. So she worked on that. She herself worked on the different color combinations. So that's the legacy of the Maheshwari sari.
Fifth issue is governance issues in startups. With the recent thrust on the entrepreneurship and startups, it becomes pertinent to discuss this aspect.
I have 2 points to make. One, on the corporate governance, there is a very good book, Unusual Billionaires, which I'm reading as of now. It has a case study of around 7 companies. And, you know, the common thread among all those case studies about all those companies is that they, these companies have a high, you know, stress on corporate governance. They have, their boards are very strong. Their management, the, you know, eye of the top person at the bottom is very, they have a keen eye on things. So all those things are there. Please go and read that book. It's by an author called Saurabh Mukherjee.
As very rightly pointed by Sri Abhishek Parikh, CEO of Atal Incubation Center at Banasthali Vidyapith, you might agree that good governance is also equally needed in startups. And also there is need to take special care while bringing the people on the board. So colleagues, here we come to the end of this module. And I trust we were able to highlight some of the emerging and interesting ideas of corporate governance for you. Thank you very much.